A few months back, I released the PicoFX. It's a simple keyboard-style hand controller for the popular arcade music game Pump It Up, as well as its various fan-made simulators, or really any rhythm game you want, as long as you can play with 10 keys or fewer. In the time since, I've been genuinely blown away by the positive reception it's had. Considering the PicoFX is designed to be easy for beginners to build themselves, I think a proper build guide is in order. In this guide, I'll be going over the full process of building a PicoFX controller, start to finish. There's more than one way to do it, so if any of the following steps seem intimidating, there's likely an easier and more beginner-friendly alternative you can try in its place. I'm also excited to announce that this video is sponsored by PCBWay, more on them later. Before we start, please bear in mind that this is an open source project, and although I currently consider it to be complete, it may receive periodic updates and improvements. So, until YouTube provides some way to edit a video that's already been uploaded, be sure to check the GitHub link in the description to ensure that the instructions are up to date, and keep it handy during the build process to cross-reference, just in case. In total, there are five main steps for building one controller, which are soldering the surface mount parts, including the RGB LEDs and the resistors for the button LEDs, soldering the mounting hardware required to attach the Raspberry Pi Pico, as well as attach the two PCBs together, soldering the single color LEDs and all the buttons, soldering the Raspberry Pi Pico in place and flashing the firmware, and assembling the shell. You can see the timestamps for each section here. You can also find a full list of components needed for this project, as well as where to order them, in the GitHub repository found in the description. To start off, we want to get all the surface mount components out of the way. If you're not experienced with surface mount soldering, don't worry, these aren't as scary as they might seem. Make sure you have a fine tip on your iron and that the temperature is around the 315 degrees Celsius range. Add some flux to the pads and a small amount of solder to one pad. Pick up the LED with a pair of tweezers, melt the solder you added to one pad, and advance the LED in from the side. It doesn't matter if this specific starting pin is kind of messy, all that matters is that it holds it in place. Don't be afraid to remelt the solder to reposition it, since you'll want to get it aligned properly before soldering the rest of the pins. Also make sure you pay attention to the orientation of the LED. In this case, the corner with the notch cutout should be facing the bottom right corner of the PCB. Add some flux and a small amount of solder to the rest of the legs. Once those are done, if the first leg didn't turn out so well, go back and add some more extra flux before reflowing the solder to ensure you have a nice and solid connection. Repeat for the five remaining LEDs. Oh, and don't worry about the pads labeled C1, C2, and so on. It's okay if you get a bit of solder on them, as long as they don't end up being bridged together. If you don't feel confident soldering components this small, here's where you have your first alternative option. Towards the right-hand side of the board, there are three pins labeled Ground, D-In, and 5V, as well as a set of pads labeled Strip Enable. You have the option of simply bridging together those two pins and soldering three wires to a pre-made LED strip, and sticking that strip along the back of the PCB. The pinout is pretty straightforward, just match up the pins with the labels on the LED strip, though make sure you solder to the D-In side and not the D-Out side. Also make sure the strip is 6 LEDs in length, because any extra LEDs past that won't light up without making changes to the firmware. If you end up doing this step instead of soldering individual surface mount LEDs, make sure you do it after soldering everything else, so that the strip doesn't get in the way. You may have to trim down some solder points later on to get it to stick nicely. That's the hardest part of this build out of the way. Everything else from here on out is pretty straightforward. Next up, we'll move on to the resistors for the individual LEDs. In case you're curious, it's technically possible to skip these and just bridge the pads together, but they're included to make sure the LEDs don't burn themselves out, so I wouldn't recommend it. These will be installed in largely the same way as the RGB LEDs. Tin one pad, heat it up, slide the component into the molten solder to tack it down, and readjust if necessary, then solder the other side. The main difference here is that the orientation of the resistor doesn't matter. You can have it facing forwards, backwards, or even upside down, not that I'd recommend that. I deliberately chose a hand solder friendly footprint for these, so you shouldn't have too difficult a time. Next up is the mounting hardware that'll be used to bridge the two PCBs as well as hold the Raspberry Pi Pico. There are two places where these need to be soldered, but one is not required if you're using a 3D printed top plate. Be sure to pay close attention to the placement and orientation of each one. The first set will stick out from the back side of the board, with the long end facing up, as shown here. Use some Kapton tape or electrical tape, or even masking tape, I'm not going to judge, to hold them in place while you flip the board over and solder them in. Something I didn't do here that you should consider when building your own is to place the Pico on the header pins to help make sure they're properly spaced when you solder it later on. Otherwise, the slightest misalignment in the pins can make it a total pain to mount. Once those are done, flip the board over to the front side and look for the three holes towards the bottom right. Snap off a row of three header pins and tape them in place, then go ahead and flip the board over to solder them in. Once again, be sure not to solder the Raspberry Pi Pico in quite yet, that happens later. Now we attach the keyboard switches and their LEDs. This build has what are referred to as south-facing LEDs, meaning that the LEDs are oriented towards you rather than away from you. This is done to ensure that there's no interference with cherry profile keycaps in case anyone does decide to use those. Go ahead and snap all your switches into the plate, making sure that none are upside down or sideways. Assuming the boards were manufactured properly, they should click in cleanly and easily without falling out. Make sure you double check that they're oriented as shown here. Once they're all in place, you can push the main PCB onto the plate, taking care to make sure each switch is fully seated and the two boards are level with one another. Now, take your LEDs and slide them into the switches, making sure that the long leg goes through the round hole on the main PCB, which is also marked with a plus icon. If the LED doesn't sit cleanly in the switch, you may have to trim the flange around the outside off. If the switches you chose don't account for in-switch LEDs, such as Kale box switches, which require them to sit underneath the housing, you may need to find smaller LEDs or even leave them out entirely. Check over all the pins on the back once or twice to make sure that they're all sticking out. If you've been paying close attention, you'll notice that I completely missed a bent pin here until after I'd already soldered most of the other switches and LEDs in, which I had to remove with a switch puller and some patience. Don't make the same mistake I did, especially if you don't own a switch puller. Sometimes the pins on the switches can be bent during shipping, which can be easy to miss until it's too late. Once you're sure everything's in position, you may begin soldering. All that's left to do in this step is to solder in the test and service buttons. Push the buttons into place, add some tape to hold them down if they don't hold themselves in properly, and solder them in place. As with the header pins, you can optionally choose to trim these down so that there are no potentially sharp solder points protruding from the top of the plate once everything is assembled. For the final step in this guide, simply drop the Raspberry Pi Pico in place on the header pins you soldered earlier, making sure that the side with the USB port is facing out. Add some flux and solder each of the pins in place, being careful not to add too much solder to your iron so that you don't have a blob of it fall down onto the PCB and bridge some pins together. Once that's done, that's it. The main unit is complete and ready to be programmed. There are currently two firmware options as of filming this video. Option 1 is the HID gamepad firmware. If you're using your PicoFX for any simulator, whether it be Step P1, Step PXX, Infinitesimal, or Kick It Up, this is the firmware you'll want to use. Option 2 is the Pump It Up I/O firmware, which is compatible with official games, but can also be used on Windows or Linux with IO2Key or a custom kernel module, respectively. However, there's new firmware with new features being worked on right now, which combines gamepad, pump it up I/O, and keyboard functionality into one single firmware, with a companion program that allows you to pick the mode you want and customize the underglow lighting. It's really cool, and I'm really excited for it, so keep an eye on the GitHub repo. To flash the firmware, hold down the boot cell button on the Pico while plugging it into your PC. It should appear as a USB mass storage device in the file browser. Simply drag and drop the UF2 file for whichever firmware you picked into this new storage device. It should almost immediately close and disconnect itself, at which point the device is programmed and ready to go. All that's left now is to assemble the shell, which is probably the easiest part. Take four M3.5 machine screws, around 8mm long, and thread them into each corner. If your case didn't come out very well, or M3.5 screws are far too tight to properly screw in, you could give M3 a try instead. Whichever screws you do pick, make sure they're not countersunk. Lastly, add your favorite keycaps and you're done. Your PicoFX is finally ready for use. Before we get to the closing section of this video, and do stick around because there are a couple more things to talk about, I'd like to give a huge thank you to PCBWay for sponsoring this video. Full disclosure, they were generous enough to provide the PCBs used in this video free of charge, but to be perfectly clear, all of the opinions expressed in this video are entirely my own. First off, I just want to say, these PCBs look fantastic. I went with the standard black solder mask for both boards, with an electroless nickel immersion gold finish on the main PCB, which improves solderability and gives you a smoother surface for placing surface mount components. Since the plate only has a few small through-hole solder points, I decided to go with a less fancy lead-free solder finish. I've also used some PCBs that had their matte black finish, and they honestly look really good as well. If you want to build a PicoFX of your own, but don't want to etch your own circuit boards, or you don't have access to a 3D printer, or perhaps none of the above, then PCBWay has got you covered. They provide all the services necessary to build one, including PCB manufacturing with optional assembly, 3D printing, and even CNC machining, all of which are super simple to get started with. Simply upload your design files to the service you want to use, pick whichever options fit your project best, and you're all set. They offer everything from simple single-layer circuit boards all the way up to complex multi-layer thick stacks, depending on the complexity of your project. They also have a bunch of different base materials available for their PCBs, as well as plenty of solder mask colors and surface finish types. If you decide to try out their white solder mask for a PicoFX build, I'd love to see it. I think it would look really cool. With all the different options available here, the potential for customization really is huge, and combined with all the different material types and styles that 3D printing offers, you'd have no trouble building a PicoFX that's entirely your own. For full instructions on how to order a batch of PCBs for this project, be sure to check out the GitHub repo. Thank you again to PCBWay. Now, on to some closing thoughts. Now that you're done assembling your PicoFX, it's time to play around with it. Feel free to try out different styles of keycaps, or if you're no stranger to embedded software, go wild and edit the firmware to customize the behavior to your liking. Once the configuration program is complete and ready for use, I'll be sure to make a video demoing its functionality and how to use it, so keep an eye out for that. If you're watching this guide before ordering parts for your own PicoFX, I strongly encourage you to customize it however you want. Make sure you do some research on the switches and other components to make sure everything will fit, but aside from that, you can make this controller 100% your own. Nearly everything that goes into this project has massive customization potential, from the huge variety of keyboard switches out there to the wide array of 3D printing materials and colors to the silk screening options made possible by modern PCB manufacturing. You can even fork the KiCad files for this project to add your own logo or graphics to the silkscreen if you want to go the extra mile. However you decide to customize your build, I would love to see it. I've opened up a channel in my Discord server specifically for the PicoFX, which you can use to discuss the project, ask questions, and show off your own. You could also tweet it at me if you want, assuming Twitter hasn't burned itself to the ground by the time this video goes live. Thanks for watching! I also want to give a special thank you to those who helped with this project, such as the Rat Hatter and 48 Productions for their work on the firmware, Spaghetti Snail and Bedrock for helping with the KiCad and design stuff, and everyone else who has supported this project.
Hey! Why don't you just get up and dance, man?